anywhere in America, this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. Good evening. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this once again tonight is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is really, in my estimation, a probing question or two. And it's for the sake, again, of parents who find their kids completely preoccupied by their sports ambitions, and parents who are wondering where school and academics and literacy might fit into this treadmill of ambition they find their kids on. So the two questions tonight are this. Does participation in sports, clear up to the most sophisticated levels, to the professional level, does participation in athletics in professional sports, does it inhibit or prohibit literacy? Can a participant, a professional player for instance, can he maintain his God-given language skills, his reading and writing skills, his literacy, if you will? Can he maintain that and yet participate in the sports industry? Let me give you one statistic that you'll find troublesome, I'm sure, and that has motivated me to ask this question. The statistic is, in 2004, and this came out publicly when Mark Pryor finally finished his bachelor's degree through correspondence work, and left the Cubs for one day to go to graduation ceremonies. You might remember this, reading this. Here's the statistic that came out. It was revealed that in 2004, and things haven't improved much, I'm sure, in 2004 in Major League Baseball, only 17 players had graduated from college. There are 750, if you haven't counted, in Major League Baseball, and just 17 had bachelor's degrees. I find that disturbing because I wonder what then happened to all those talents of theirs in the affective category, you know? Or are they missing out on a whole dimension in life that would enrich them and their families for years to come after baseball, after sports? So, in an attempt to throw some light on that, is literacy inhibited or prohibited by participation in athletics all the way up to the professional level, and particularly there, does that occur, the inhibition and the prohibition of literacy? In order to answer that question, I fortuitously came upon a neighbor of ours, one Kevin Guilfoile. Perhaps you know the name. Perhaps you've already read his book, Cast of Shadows, which was at one time the number two bestseller in the Chicago area. I want to show you his rather handsome face, if you'll just hold on a second. Yes, right here. This is Kevin Guilfoile at in his very best. Looks like Peck's bad boy here with the turtleneck hiding. But this is a Chicago Tribune magazine feature article in which you get to read something about his background and then an explanation of his writing skills and the impact he's making in the so-called psychological thriller genre, as they say. And he's here with us tonight. Now, you're saying, well, he's an author. What about the sports end of it? And this is supposed to be a sports talk show that informs parents and players alike. Well, here is the ironic surprise. Kevin Guilfoile grew up in a professional baseball family. He himself has worked for two different Major League Baseball teams, namely the Pittsburgh Pirates and the Houston Astros. He worked there in the media relations department. I guess that might be the most literate department of all for both of those clubs. Hope they're not listening. His father, William Guilfoile, was the assistant public relations director for the New York Yankees at one time, and at another time, the public relations director of the Pittsburgh Pirates, and for 22 years was associated with the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York, as a vice president, operationals vice president. So Kevin Guilfoile is not only a proven most literate individual, an author right here in our midst, but he has had the experience of the sports industry. So my question will be hit to him tonight. Can young men and women maintain their literacy in the sports domain? Aren't you worried about that? Aren't you worried that your son or daughter is going to be swifted away to their sports fantasy and leaving all the academics behind? Let's find out if literacy survives the ambition. All right, Kevin. That might have said enough, I guess. Might have said enough. I'd like to show you all, as a matter of credibility. This is his novel that's available just about everywhere in America, for that matter. He's been on book tour all over the country, have you?
Yep, sure has.
Signing. You can find it at Borders or Barnes & Noble easily. And it has been reviewed by some of the most experienced and adept critics around America and the world, for that matter. For instance, Henry Kaiser of the Chicago Sun-Times says that Kevin Guilfoile has there's as much fascinating science as in a Michael Crichton thriller. It's quite a comparison, between Michael Crichton and Kevin Guilfoile. That's for your stead. That's very good. But Guilfoile's characters are much more rounded and believable. Here's a young writer to keep an eye on. An always surprising medical thriller with elegant prose and well-developed characters, says Michael Schoen of the New York Times Book Review. Publishers Weekly called this novel engrossing, provocative, rich, and involving. And on and on and on and on. Remarkable. And you live right. He lives right here in LaGrange. You believe it? Just by rubbing elbows, we become more literate. So, all right, Kev. Boy, you graduated from Notre Dame in 1990.
I did.
But you're from Teaneck, New Jersey, originally.
Well, yeah, we moved from there when I was only about 2 years old. My father left the Yankees and went to work for the Pirates in 1970. Yeah. So.
Did you attend private high school?
No, I went to Cooperstown High School.
You did?
Yeah, but 94 in my graduating class, maybe.
94.
Yeah, but it was an excellent high school. It was a terrific
high
school.
Were the other kids from families of employees of the Hall of Fame? Or?
No, there was a real diverse group of people there. A lot of them were from farm families. There's also a teaching hospital there in Cooperstown, so a lot of them were the children of doctors. But
so you left Cooperstown when you were 15, is that right?
No, I went away to college.
When you went away to school. Yeah. So you were home until you were about 18 or 19.
That's right.
And you went off to Notre Dame. That must have been tough to get into Notre Dame from a public high school in Cooperstown, New York.
Well, not really. My high school was, I had two kids in my class went to Harvard, and then went to Brown. My high school was actually excellent.
Wow. Yeah, so impressive.
Yeah.
Okay. Any hijinks at Cooperstown when you were a kid? Did you ever sneak into the archives or anything like that?
Well, I didn't have to sneak in. My father would give me a tour of the basement every once in a while when I asked for it. But
what the most interesting artifact you ever got to put your hands on?
Oh, my gosh. There's so many of them. Oh, boy. Having grown up in that family and having grown and as a child being such a big Pittsburgh Pirates fan, I think maybe Bill Mazeroski's bat from the 1960
really,
World Series.
The home run.
That's
60.
Really electric.
You were a Pirates fan, even though your dad worked in PR for the Yankees?
Well, remember, he worked for the Yankees before I was born.
Okay, then he worked for the Pirates.
Right, so up until I was about fifth grade, he worked for the Pirates, so we lived in Pittsburgh until then. So I started as a Pittsburgh Pirates fan.
So you were practically hanging out at the ballpark then, too?
Every night. My mom and my brothers would, my sister would go down to the ballpark every night. Just about every night there was a game, yeah.
Any spring training experiences?
Yeah, we would, the whole family moved to Florida for spring training. We would live in Florida for almost 2 months. I go to school down there in Bradenton.
And then you'd break camp.
Yeah.
And go back north.
I'd have to do double the coursework, actually. I'd have to do homework from Pittsburgh. I'd have all my books and all my assignments, and I'd have to do the coursework from in Bradenton, too.
And you still got into Notre Dame. What did you know?
Well, my dad went to Notre Dame.
Was he a graduate? Yeah.
And
it always helps.
Yeah, it does.
Well, wow, that's so interesting. So you, am I being fair in saying that you are describing for me a young man, who's pretty much embedded in the baseball culture?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we, you know, to the point where I didn't even realize it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just second nature. Baseball mm-hmm. was family business. And, you know, I don't even think until it was later, maybe even until after I went away to college, maybe, or, you know, when I was an adult, when I really realized what an odd upbringing it was.
Yeah,
well, and wonderful. Odd and wonderful.
Well, kids would die to do what you did.
Yeah.
To die. My God, to be hands-on at Cooperstown? Babe Ruth's uniform? I'd be trying it on, I'm sure. Okay, so then you graduate from Notre Dame, where you worked in the sports information department.
I did.
Were you director of sports information at Notre Dame?
Oh, no. I was a student assistant for 4 years.
Yeah.
And then after I graduated, I came back as an intern. Notre Dame is a large sports information department, as you can imagine. So, but I was involved in just about every sport on campus, from fencing to football on Saturdays. It was a terrific experience.
Okay, so you get the internship with the Pirates,
right?
In their media department,
right?
And what were your duties there?
My duties were to answer a lot of fan mail and. Go down to the clubhouse every day and get autographs for kids in the hospital or, you know, people who.
What year was this?
This would have been 89.
89.
So Barry Bonds, Bobby Bonilla, Andy Van Slyke.
Wow.
Were the big stars there.
But definitely smaller Barry Bonds at that point.
Yeah, he's a leadoff hitter. He's a speedy little guy.
Yeah. Like that. We forget this. Yeah.
That's right.
A leadoff hitter at about 190.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's slightly different.
He's about half Bobby.
He's configured slightly differently. Okay, so you worked there, and then when you left the Pirates, what happened?
Well, I did that the summer between my junior and senior year of college. So I went back to Notre Dame, and I went back to the sports information department there. After I spent another year in South Bend after my graduation working for sports information as the baseball, soccer, and wrestling SID, actually. And then after that, I got a job with Sports Channel here in Chicago, the now defunct Sports Channel. But
doing what?
Advertising and media relations.
Mm-hmm.
And I spent a year doing that at their office in Oaks Park. And but I still had a hand in sports and still going to games and still involved with the White Sox and the Bulls.
Then after Sports Channel, you joined a firm called the Caudill Brothers?
Well, no, actually, before while I was at Sports Channel, I got a job with the Astros. So I moved to Houston for a year. And I worked in their media relations department, actually. I was the assistant to the media relations director, and then I also was the manager of publications. So I edited the yearbook and the media
book.
Guide and the program.
That's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's important work, too.
But fun, you know, it was fun to go to the ballpark.
And then you left the Astros, and you spent 11 years as the creative director for Caudill, is that pronounced correctly?
Caudill Partners.
Caudill Partners.
Well, this Jim Caudill was a guy who had been doing Sports Channel's advertising when I was at Sports Channel.
Mm-hmm.
He decided that he wanted to start his own agency, so he called me when I was in Houston and asked if I would come back to Chicago to help him start this agency. So it started with just the two of us.
And you had no problem leaving professional baseball to do that?
That part was hard. I really loved going to the ballpark every day, and I loved being a part of an organization that at the end of every day, or at the end of 162 days anyway, you won or lost.
Yeah.
You know, that was a lot of fun. But as it happened, about 6 weeks before I moved to Houston, I met the woman who would one day become my wife.
End of the story.
I realized I wasn't in Houston very long before I realized she wasn't going to move down there.
I see. There wasn't any mourning about being away from baseball.
Oh, it was...
Because by my count, from birth to age, would it be age 30? From birth to age 30, you were
Not quite. I was 25 when I left.
Okay, from birth to, for 25 years, you were embedded in baseball.
Yeah, pretty much. But it softened the blow a little bit. Kudal Partners did a lot of sports marketing. We had the White Sox that are Jim Kudal actually wrote "Good Guys Wear Black," that slogan for White Sox. Yeah. So when I started, we were doing the Blackhawks, we were doing the White Sox, we were doing Sports Channel, and then Fox Sports Net. So I was still involved in sports marketing on a pretty heavy level up until I wrote the book and left Kudal Partners.
And at no one point in time did you miss not being able to be part of the scene?
Oh, sure I missed it.
Huh? I mean, knowing Barry Bonds on a first name basis, you didn't miss
I didn't miss that so much.
You didn't, no.
I didn't miss Barry.
He was
Barry might have been the view. Yeah. One of the few things about baseball I don't miss. But he's not a nice person. But I really did love baseball. I loved working for a team,
Of course, feeling of oneness, the unity.
It's not like working for a professional sports team isn't like any other thing. It's hard work and it's not much pay.
Yeah, that's right.
But
the only people making the money are the players,
And it's a lot of hours. Yeah, but it's a lot of fun.
Okay. Here's a prime question. Maybe we're jumping the gun, and maybe we shouldn't ask it here at the end of our first segment. But at least it will serve as an introduction to where we're going in the next 15 minutes. The question is, here you are, a very literate graduate of the University of Notre Dame, of all places. Okay? And you're creating copy for the Pirates and the Astros from scratch. And it's important copy because all their marketing depends upon it. It can depend upon it, right? I mean, the promotions, it's promotional propaganda important to the proliferation.
Sure.
Okay. At any one point in time, did you feel that was an abuse of your literary skills?
No.
No?
No, not you at didn't. All. No, not at all. I studied journalism and marketing when I was in college, and baseball was a passion of mine, and it seemed perfectly natural to me.
You never had any urge to break out of that mold and write something outside of that box?
Well, I did do that.
You did?
You know, in addition, you know, I was writing magazine articles and short humor and doing a sort of moonlighting, or writing other things as well.
Away from the setting, away from baseball.
Yeah.
On your own.
But, this is what my father did, too. I couldn't think of anything more respectable than...
I understand that. I'm not intimating that there's anything wrong.
Oh, I know.
What I'm trying to get to is there a limiting factor to the setting, limiting of particularly the literacy skill?
Oh well, I mean, there's a formula to it. I mean, you know that. It's limiting in that point. And if that's all you did, and you had any sort of ambitions in terms of literary ambitions at all, I think you would become frustrated. Yeah. But that's why you sort of took advantage of other opportunities to try to write outside.
We're gonna pound away with that aspect. I want to know whether or not your literacy is stunted when you hang around with Barry Bonds. I think it is. But we'll be back in just about a minute. We have to break for public service announcements. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan. I'm with Kevin Guilfoile, author, former professional baseball employee, and we are discussing literacy and the inhibition of it in sports, if that exists at all. We'll be back in 1 minute. Please stay with us.
The sun'll come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow. Hear the way the cobwebs and sorrow. Till there's none. When I'm sick in the day. That's gray and lonely. I just stick out my chin and grin and say, oh, oh, ooh.
Is our hope. Please give today.
Ah! Yeah! 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 Nobody really likes to vacuum, but it's an everyday chore that I don't really take for granted anymore. I've had a heart transplant. Prior to my transplant, I couldn't even walk to my mailbox without feeling really, really tired. The heart transplant has given me my life back, but it's not just my life anymore. It's allowed me to have a son. And this is Trent. He's a handful, but a good handful. Without this heart transplant, I would actually not be around anymore.
Good job, looking back.
The transplant has allowed me to be a regular mom. I'm able to take my son to the park. I'm able to push him on his bike. Anything that a young mom loves to do with her kid, I do.
You have the power to donate life. Be an organ and tissue donor. To find out how, go today to donatelife.net.
Thanks for coming back again. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner. We're at Now Serving Deli and Cafe on Hillgrove Avenue in LaGrange. And I have with me one Kevin Guilfoile, who's a resident of LaGrange and an accomplished author and a former professional baseball employee. You may have read the feature article about him in the Chicago Tribune magazine back during the summer, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Was it published in the summer?
March.
March of 2005. Very definitive and explanatory of this young man's burgeoning career as an author of the psychological thriller genre. Am I giving you the right genre?
Sure.
No? The psychological thriller?
Sure.
And this is what the book looks like. Available everywhere. Cast of Shadows. Now, if you happen to be living in Britain, then it will look like this. And over there it's called Wicker, which is a reference to cricket.
No. Actually, it is a reference in the book, but it's just the British publisher liked that title better.
No, it's interesting how the publishing world works. Knopf Publishing?
Right.
Knopf Publishing has taken it around the world. This is what the book would look like in the UK, United Kingdom. And this is what the cover would look like in Italy. And if you happen to be in Czechoslovakia, if you're looking for Kevin's book, this is how you'll find it. You'll identify it this way. This is good. So it's a bit worldwide press, international acclaim. And again, a couple of remarks from various critics. Where are my remarks? Oh, well, misplaced my remarks. We'll get to that another time. But we are discussing whether or not being embedded in professional sports or persisting in the ambition toward professional sports may or may not affect your literacy. This valuable thing, this very personal, some would even call it your inner voice, is that whether or not this is affected. Are your parents worried about this? That your kids will become one-dimensional because that's all they're concentrating is on sports, as we say, as parents often say to kids, you're putting all your eggs in one basket. What about their literary skills? What about their cultural interests? Is any of that inhibited or stunted when you really are in the arena of professional sports? And we have with us a published author who's been there, with the Pittsburgh Pirates, the Houston Astros, his father Bill with the New York Yankees and also with the Pirates, and one of the vice presidents of the Baseball Hall of Fame where Kevin grew up until he left for Notre Dame. Notre Dame! I know there's a lot of people watching who will like that aspect. I quoted a statistic last portion about in 2004, there are only 17 players in the big leagues who graduated from college. I want to give you another statistic, and then I want you to respond to that. The other statistic is that when a player signs, when a draft pick signs, let's say it's a kid out of high school, and he signs with a major league club, he's drafted by the Chicago Cubs, and he signs with the Chicago Cubs, but he has already had, at that point in time, a college scholarship offer. He's already signed a letter of intention with a college. The major league club is obligated to pay for that young man's college education. So he gets his signing bonus and he gets his college money. I'm sure you're familiar with this.
Yeah.
All right. The statistic is, and by the way, that money, that college money, is not given to the player, the drafted player, or the parents of the drafted player. That money sits in an escrow account in the baseball commissioner's office. Right. Here's the scary statistic. 95%, and these are the commissioner's statistics themselves, you know, this is not someone's propaganda. This comes from the commissioner's office. 95% of that college money is never used.
No, I'm not surprised.
Never used. Is it, why is that?
Well, I mean, I think that there's an institutional situation with baseball. I won't call it a problem because I don't think that, you know, it's just sort of the way it is and the way baseball is developed as opposed to, say, football and basketball. But because baseball has this extensive minor league system that you know very well about, but that a player is drafted, especially if they're drafted out of college, maybe even more so than they're out of high school, they know that it's going to be several years before they make it to the major league.
Big league,
as opposed to a football player who's drafted or a basketball player who's drafted, who knows they're either going to make the team or they're not, or they'll have plenty of time to go back to school if they don't make it.
Right.
So there is a real disadvantage in a player's mind, I think, especially when he's 19 years old and he gets drafted by the Dodgers, and, you know, and picked 42nd or whatever, and gets a nice check in his hand. He knows that, well, I could stick around in college and wait out another 2 or 3 years in college, then go in the minor leagues, then wait another 6 years before I make the majors, if I'm lucky.
Yeah.
Or I could start that process right now. And I think in his mind, he's thinking, get the quickest way to the majors is to get into the minor league system as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's true for, and baseball is also the only, not the only, but when you know, there's all this uproar about the NBA drafting kids out of high school, but nobody's even talking about Major League Baseball draft out of high school they take. You probably know the numbers, it's an enormous number.
Most clubs draft almost 50 rounds of drafting in professional baseball. Most clubs draft half high school players.
Yeah.
So 50 rounds, 25 of them are high school.
I mean, any kid who has, who anybody really thinks is a real prospect at 17 years old, the chances of him ever even setting foot on the campus are probably pretty slim.
Yeah.
Because somebody's going to throw a whole bunch of money at him.
Okay. Of course, the flip side of this biased statistic that I gave you about the 95% and the 17 players only in the big leagues. The flip side of that is this: there are 750 players, and by according to Baseball America publication, 482 of them are millionaires.
That's right.
So, where does school fit into this?
Well, then you take a look at how many of those guys are in, never get out of the minors, and you know that
there's plenty of them sitting down there dying
and
in the minors.
That's a tough life.
Yeah,
shuffling around.
I worry much more about the minor leaguer in hockey or baseball. Whether or not that person's literacy is extinguished, because that lifestyle is a lot worse, and there's no opportunity whatsoever to get back to school once they're down there.
That's right.
It's brutal. Okay. By the way, as a teenager, did you ever entertain the idea to be an athlete?
I think you daydream about those kinds of things, but I think one of the advantages or maybe disadvantages of being in a you know, quote unquote baseball family was that I had a pretty realistic view of what my prospects really were. And I also had a brother, actually two brothers, who were much better baseball players than I was. And, you know, I could see 4 and 8 years ahead of me that nobody was interested in them. Yeah. So, I was pretty obvious.
So you measured yourself at an early age.
Yeah, but I was never... I played a lot of baseball. You know, Cooperstown, every high school state champion in the country would come in the summer to come play in Cooperstown, and they would play us. Mm-hmm. This was sort of ragtag group of guys. We would play three games in a day, through most of the summer, and wouldn't even be the same nine guys. I worked across the street. I'd work in my uniform at the Farm and Home Bargain Center as a stock boy. I'd run across the street to Doubleday Field. I'd tag somebody. I'd say, "All right, I can play for an hour." He'd go home to the farm, and do whatever work he had to do. I'd play a couple innings. I'd run back across the street and I'd unload a truck.
What was your favorite position?
I was second base.
Where?
I wish that I had. We would just get beat. We'd get beat three times a day, every day. We were the Washington Generals of youth baseball. We'd be like the team that the Harlem Globetrotters beats every year. We just lose. But the I wish it never occurred to me, but I wish that I had taken a lineup card from every team that we played, because I'm sure.
Yeah, there were
that
names
we played
on there.
Some on,
you know what?
Real
about being beat up on and whatnot and having to go to work. Do you know what Shakespeare said about authors or playwrights?
I don't know.
Shakespeare said that it was never the rich kids or the happy ones who wrote the plays. Yeah,
no,
it was
true.
Never the rich kids or the happy ones who wrote the plays. So maybe you're in the pain and suffering of being a loser day in and day out and having to work to earn a buck, maybe that's where you're...
I would never claim that I wasn't happy. I had a
very good
job.
Of course.
Losing it all.
Am I being unfair to describe your childhood and adolescence as pretty much preoccupied with baseball? Was the family kind of directed by wherever baseball sent them? And certainly when your dad was with the Yankees and the Pirates, look at the one transition from New York to Pittsburgh dictates what the family's going to do, right?
Oh, yeah. We moved, the family moved around a lot even before I was born. I guess to a certain degree, although, for most of my life I was in Cooperstown and pretty settled, and we lived a pretty good life. My father's work was much more 9-to-5 in Cooperstown than it was when he was working for a baseball team and working 6 a.m. till midnight during a homestand or whatever. But baseball paid the bills, and so.
Did you feel that you've got as much a sense of approval from your early academics achievements from your mom and dad, particularly from your dad, as you might have from your baseball achievements at Cooperstown Tigers?
Oh, much more.
You got much more for the academics.
Oh, yeah. My father was very, very, my mother, both of my parents were very, very serious about the academics. They would show, even we would play the games and they would show up, they would do it very quietly and they'd watch the games. They're very encouraging, but they were much more
interested.
Well,
this is remarkable. Given where your dad had been, working for the Yanks, working for the Pirates, and then watching his own son and I'm sure he was guarded in his gifting of approval so that you wouldn't get the impression that the baseball thing was important.
Yeah, he struck a pretty good balance, I think he did a nice job.
It's a difficult parenting skill, it's artful.
Yeah.
To not let them think that doing well in sports is a way they get approval and more love.
Right.
Very difficult thing.
You want to encourage them too, when they're doing stuff they enjoy.
So you never ever, when you were in school, did you ever, ever devalue the academics because you wanted baseball or sports more? You never said this stuff's getting in my way. You never said to yourself.
I don't think so. No. I cut back not on baseball, but after my freshman year, I cut back from 3 sports to 2, but it then involved in other things, in student government. And I had a job. I worked 7 days a week, and I did all these other things. So,
did you have an English teacher? Did you ever experience an English teacher who kind of turned your head about the arts or literature?
Oh gosh, I had a teacher named Nick Alessino, who was my English teacher in 9th grade. Really encouraged me as a writer. Without him, I'm almost certain that I wouldn't be a writer.
Have you told him this?
Unfortunately, he was a young guy, but he contracted a very rare disease, and he passed away 3 months before my book was published.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it was just heartbreaking. But a wonderful guy and an incredible teacher. It's interesting, this year, another, not one of my classmates, but a girl who was 2 years behind me published her first novel.
Really?
And she actually dedicated her book.
Did she?
To Nick, yeah.
This guy must have been really engaging.
He was an amazing teacher,
huh?
Yeah.
See that? How kids are affected, even at that point in time. They may know that that's their favorite teacher, but they don't realize the lasting impact of that personality on them.
And a tennis coach.
He was a tennis coach.
Yeah.
That's the perfect blend. A teacher and a coach.
That's right.
Because the classroom is not very emotional, but that tennis court or that baseball field is. There's a lot of leverage when you're the coach. Okay, when you made the conscious decision to leave the Astros,
right,
in their media relations department, to join again the Kudal Partners, this advertising public relations firm.
That's right.
What was the setting of that decision? Was it more money? Was it family-oriented thing, or you saw down the road this was better for all of us? Or?
Yeah, well, I mean, it was...
Or let me interrupt. Or was this your... Did you see this as your chance to write real stuff?
No, I did it for a girl.
Right? You did it. Okay, well, okay.
I started dating the woman who eventually became my wife right before I moved to Houston.
Yeah.
And as soon as I realized she wasn't moving to Texas, I started looking for ways to move back.
Did she realize what you gave up here? Did she realize you did this?
Oh,
she knows now. She'll know tonight.
I don't think she looks at it that I gave anything up. Okay. I think she looks at it as her imparting wisdom on me.
By the way, you have a newborn child. I mean, how long has it been?
It's almost 2 years.
2 years. It's a boy.
Yeah.
And what do you see down the road for him? Is he going to be playing Little League? And
oh, man. Oh, I hope. Well, you know, that's up to him. I would love that. But.
Pen in hand or bat in hand?
We'll see.
Yeah, we will see.
He throws the ball around pretty good already.
We'll see if you can emulate your dad's balancing act.
That's right.
Yeah. You probably
will. I've
been
getting a lot of advice from him.
Sounds like you might have learned from a good, artful parent.
I did.
Okay. Two, right. Your mom also. I shouldn't forget mom. Moms are keep the glue of all families. At no point in time did anyone ever ridicule you in professional sports because you could write a complete sentence.
I got ridiculed a lot, but I don't know if it was because I could write.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the two locker rooms that I was around, the 89 Pirates and the 91-92 Astros, they were pretty. They're pretty smart. I mean, Barry Bonds is incredibly smart. You can say what else you want about him, but he is he's one of the smartest guys I've ever met.
Yeah.
And Craig Biggio, smart guy.
Yeah.
You know, I remember riding a bus on a press caravan, with Kevin Bass. You remember Kevin Bass? And he was with the Astros.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's reading, like,
what's
Financial
reading?
Times and the
was
Wall
he?
Street Journal.
Oh, I know. They're all
Fortune
invested.
Fortune Magazine. And, you know.
They're all invested.
Yeah. I mean, memories of those guys were not intellectuals for the most part, but the guys that I were around were pretty smart guys.
The Wall Street Journal is found in the dirt of most bullpens. It's found underneath the bench.
That's right. And most of them are thinking about their broadcasting career after it's over anyway. So I mean, they know that this is going to be over at 35, and they're still going to be a young guy, and they have to think about what's next.
At any time when you were working for the Pirates or the Astros, were you writing? Outside of that setting, were you writing things that you wanted to write? Were you writing creatively?
Yeah, I was just starting to do that. I started to write mostly humor, short humor, and that really sort of took off after I started working at Kudal Partners, and a lot of that was the explosion of the internet in the late 90s. There were a lot of websites that were actually paying and a pretty good dollar for essays and short humor and pieces, and that led to magazine work and so forth and so on. So yeah, I was moonlighting basically. I'd come home and at night and on weekends I would write other stuff. The stuff that I
Is writing painful for you?
It's hard work. Yeah. It's not painful. I mean, I enjoy doing it, but it's hard. You know, it's hard. It's hard. It's painful the days when it doesn't.
When
happen.
It doesn't happen. When the black
when you're trying and it doesn't
you
happen.
You feel conflicted.
Yeah.
But and unsatisfied.
Right. I mean, that's
it's painful. It's like taking the golden sombrero of three strikeouts. It's like the three strikeout day or the four strikeout day plus an error.
Right. But you know that the next day will be better and that'll be a good one.
Well, the next segment will be better. So we have to take a break. We have to take
what
a break here.
That one?
It was a good one. We're getting to the point. We're getting to the point. Is your literacy inhibited by participation in athletics, even at the most sophisticated levels? We will be back. The federal government says we have to take a break for public service announcements. And we're going to do that, Channel 99 or 16, depending on where you're living. But we'll be right here waiting for you on the inside corner. Come back, please.
I'm John. I was blinded in a chemical explosion that left me blind for 30 years. I was given my sight back through a cornea transplant. All I had wanted was to see my children for the very first time. When they removed the bandages, I looked across the room, and sitting there was my family. I could see them.
You have the power to donate life. Be an organ and tissue donor. To find out how, go today to donatelife.net.
How far would you go to help someone? Would you go to the end of your driveway? Would you cross a street? Would you cross an ocean? Would you go if you could use your knowledge to teach someone? And in the process, maybe learn something yourself. Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps.
Do something powerful. Support the Breast Cancer Research Foundation and knock out breast cancer. We're funding research to find prevention and a cure in our lifetime. In our 10th anniversary year, we have the power of 10 working for us. The Breast Cancer Research Foundation. Just give us the power. Together we can knock out breast cancer for good.
For the people in our armed forces, it's a time of sacrifice, a time of duty. That's why we've joined together to form the Armed Forces Relief Trust to help military families cope with financial and medical emergencies at home. The four military aid societies gave millions last year to cover unexpected medical expenses, childcare, and more. But with so many overseas, the need is greater than ever. They're serving us. Let's serve them in return.
Thanks for coming back. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Inside Corner. We're here at Now Serving Cafe on Hillgrove Avenue, where we've been treated to cheese quesadillas and some very good pastries. Don't they look great? Look at that. I can't eat them because I already have about a 38 waistline. That's why I always wear black, if you've noticed. But I'm here with Kevin Guilfoile, author, a LaGrange resident, former professional baseball employee, and we're discussing literacy and the effect of sports upon that literacy. I showed you some of his novel, Cast of Shadows, which is, again, selling very well and gaining critical acclaim. By the way, the New York Times said, gripping, Mr. Guilfoile's tricky, high-concept plot continually subverts and plays with the reader's expectations, the New York Times. But he's also written some shorter pieces in this anthology entitled Chicago Noir. You have an anthology of short stories, and Kevin's is in here. It's called The 00 Day. And like all the other short stories in the collection, it uses a Chicago, historic perhaps, Chicago intersection as its setting. His happens to be Grand and Racine, which is this intersection near a historic Italian neighborhood in Chicago. Okay. We would refer to it as Noble Street. That's the way I knew it as a kid. Who published this?
Akashic Books, New York. Great New York? Independent publisher in New York. They're doing, they started last year with Brooklyn Noir. They did a similar thing. And now they're rolling them out all over.
Really?
San Francisco Noir.
I see.
And
I see.
DC Noir and Dublin Noir.
Dublin. If you lived in Ireland, Kevin, which is what maybe one day you will, because in Ireland, did you know this? All authors, playwrights, poets, and other creative sorts, if published, are tax-free, are not taxed on their profits.
I should think about that.
Yes. You should. It's the truth. They're not taxed because in Ireland, they place value on their office. In fact, in the airport in Dublin, many of you out there have probably been there, when you get off the plane in Dublin, they do not have pictures of their famous sports stars.
Right.
At O'Hara, we have Michael Jordan, and this year I'm sure there'll be something from the White Sox. But when you get off the plane in Dublin, Ireland, it does tell you something about their culture and where they place their significance, their values. They have pictures of Brendan Behan, Samuel Beckett, James Joyce, life size of all of their famous authors and poets right there in the airport terminal. It tells you a little bit about the differences between cultures. I was going to ask you about how you got into, we'll get back to the writing, but I want to know, how did you get into the baseball media relations business?
Well, right? You know, I had in mind, you know, that I would sort of follow my father's footsteps a little bit, obviously. But I did something when I went to Notre Dame that I think that anybody who sort of a secret. It's a very well-kept secret. But anybody who's interested, anybody's in high school or currently in college, who's interested in a career in sports, I can't stress this highly enough. There's something that you can do that will greatly increase.
Okay. What is the secret?
That is on the first day you're on, first week you're on campus, no matter whether it's a big school or a small, you know, Division I, Division II, Division III, if, mm-hmm. if the school plays intercollegiate sports, they have a sports information department, most likely.
Yes.
And the first week you're on campus, you should find out where that office is, go there, knock on the door, and say, I want to volunteer to work in this office. Okay. And almost all of them, large or small, the one thing they have in common is that they're understaffed and overworked. Mm-hmm. And they will most likely say, can you start this minute?
Really?
And you will gain, you won't make, you know, some of them might pay, some of them might not. You probably volunteer, you probably might work a lot of hours. But after 4 years of college, you will have so much experience. You'll have 4 years of experience in the sports business, in a huge, you know, multi-billion dollar mm-hmm. sports business. And, you know, doing everything from, you know, writing press releases and feature stories and doing statistics and interacting with the media.
Right.
And all of these things that even if you don't decide to go into sports, if you decide to go into something else, they're all skills that transfer easily into any other thing.
At Notre Dame, sports information department is a big operation.
It's a big operation.
I mean, it's a major university, and they're nationally, I mean, they're always on television. I mean, we know how important attention is, how much attention there is to Notre Dame. So there must be a high percentage of the sports information department students who go on to that, doing that for a profession.
There's sports information directors all over the country who came out of Notre Dame.
Is it?
But it's not just a big school where that experience is valuable. Yeah. In fact, at a smaller school, you probably have even more. You know, more.
So
to
what I'm saying is, it looks good on your credentials if that's what you're. If you want to break into professional sports other than as an athlete, and there's so many other categories. You know, the athletes only make up 25 people on the roster. There's another 500 employees working for the Chicago White Sox.
Well, you know, I get so many calls from people, from, you know, friends of friends or whatever, who are graduating from college, saying, I'm graduating in 3 months. I'd like to get into the sports business. What can I do? And I try to be encouraging, but for a lot of them, I tell them it's too late. Yeah. Because there are not that many jobs in the sports business. There are thousands of people who want them.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of kids who already have 3-4 years experience when they graduate from college. And
so that's the key. That's the secret, you think.
Yeah.
Knock on the door. I want to volunteer.
Say, I want to work here.
Let me work here.
Yeah.
I can do this and I can do more later. And, you know, that's
right.
Well, you're right about the thousands of people who want those jobs in professional sports.
Which is why they're long hours and low pay.
There's lots. Yeah, that's why they just
don't
pay much at all. And there's hardly any security. And
but a lot of fun.
It's a system-based run on fear because they can always replace you.
That's right.
All right, let me talk to you about your writing experiences. With all the baseball in your background, is there a novel coming? Is there a novel coming with baseball as a setting? Or for that matter, do you find yourself unconsciously or consciously using baseball metaphor? Which? Is there a baseball novel coming?
I don't know.
Or is it too much of a cliche?
Well, I sometimes think, as much as I love baseball and love all sports, I sometimes think too many words are written about them.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I mean, and not just written, but set. I mean, between sports radio and sports pages and everything,
Hackney,
I sometimes think that we spend too much. We spend more time talking about sports than we do enjoying them.
Yeah, too much attention altogether. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, part of me is reluctant to sort of pile on.
Yeah.
But there's always, you know, all my books usually, I mean, there's everybody's a baseball fan in my books, for, you know,
really?
Usually
okay,
there's usually a game on in the background.
Stephen King does the same thing.
You know, at some point, And, you know, it's funny, I was in a bookstore and I saw a book on a shelf that said, Murder at the Baseball Hall of Fame.
No.
Yeah, and I said, oh, that's interesting, you know, and I picked it up and I sort of paged through it and, you know, I looked in the back to see what else the guy had written.
Yeah.
There are 6 books back there. Murder at the Football Hall of Fame, Murder at the Tennis Hall of Fame, Murder at the Basketball Hall of Fame.
Oh, man.
It was like, you know, the guy's got
cheap.
He's got something going there, I guess, but
cheap.
I put the book back.
You know, not only is there too much being said about sports, but I'd be the first one to be willing to admit there's too much attention given the sports, period, and the celebrity status. And this is where kids get the wrong impression. that they're not going to be anybody unless they reach their unrealistic expectations of being a pro or being a rock star. And it's just, you know, not only is it highly competitive and unlikely, but it's superficial.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's too much being written. In a sense, I'm glad. But there have been some great baseball novels as of late. Shoeless Joe by William Kinsella.
Yeah, I met Bill Kinsella at Notre Dame. He came to Notre Dame when I was there.
Oh,
yeah.
Man, I love that novel.
It's a great book.
If you don't know that novel, that is the, this is what we call it, the it became Field of Dreams.
Right.
The movie version, Field of Dreams.
Yeah, another,
but there's some wonderfully lyric passages in there about the nature of baseball and its place in our society and our culture. Beautiful stuff.
Another great book before that called the Iowa Baseball.
The Iowa Baseball Conspiracy? Yes.
Conspiracy? Read about a game that never ends.
Yeah.
About a game that goes.
Read that
end.
Too.
It's really, really good
stuff.
Yeah.
But he's able to scale the sport of baseball to its proper place and function in our history and society.
Right.
His character in Field of Dreams, the parallel character for J.D. Salinger.
In the book it was J.D. Salinger.
It is J.D. Salinger in the book, yes.
In the movie
it's somewhat Terrence Mann.
Right, yeah, right.
And Terrence Mann remarks, the only thing that hasn't changed in our history, in the history of America, is baseball.
Right, right.
If you know here, remember Mikey makes that remark on the field when he's trying to convince Cosner's character not to sell the
right. Bill Kinsella, a Canadian too. Interesting, right?
Is he really?
Yeah, these are great baseball books, but yeah.
So you were enamored by those books.
Oh yeah, I love those books.
But not enough so to write another one like it.
But you know, I'm never say never, right?
Yeah.
But you know, right now I'm sort of maybe at another time, maybe on a minimal.
All right, I appreciate that. Your regimen, your writing regimen.
Hmm.
Now you have a young child.
Yeah.
And are you a writer that has to be distraction free?
I don't think I have that option anymore.
Yeah, see,
really.
That's what I mean. Yeah. You have the young child.
Yeah. I wish I could be distraction free, but I write when he sleeps. That's the story.
So you're writing from.
I'm home with him, so.
So.
I am.
He naps. You may feel like writing,
yeah.
Much like Ernest Hemingway, who cut himself a portion of the day and wrote no matter what. If it all wound up in a garbage can, he wrote from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. every day, no matter what.
Yeah,
is that you?
Yeah, basically. So I mean, I don't have that.
He goes
much
down
time.
For a nap.
I start writing.
He goes down for a nap. You begin to write.
Yeah.
He goes to bed in the evening. You find that clear time to write. Your wife is working, correct?
Right.
Your wife is working. So she must be, she is in bed at a reasonable time. So there you are. You're left up burning midnight oil, writing?
Sometimes.
Yeah. When do you quit? When the inspiration leaves you? When you lose the train of thought? When?
Yeah, most of the time I quit because something else intervenes. You know, either I'm tired or Max wakes up or... whatever.
Well, then how do you get back? How do you insert yourself back in plot and character?
It's hard.
It's difficult.
Yeah, it's difficult.
I mean, because you're not writing in full chapters.
No.
I think readers often get that impression.
No.
You know, they get the impression that, oh, he must have stopped here one night because that's the end of the chapter.
Right, right.
But there's no telling where the author drew the curtain.
That's right. Anymore.
So here you are with a young child, and your writing regimen's kind of built around your parenthood.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Your parenting.
Yeah.
It must be, again, it's really difficult to get back into that character.
It is harder to write this book. It was easier to write a book when I had a full-time job and I was writing, you know, nights, weekends, and writing around, a work week than it is now to write my second book when I'm home all day with a toddler. It was much easier to write the book the other way.
What's his name, by the way?
Max.
Max.
But it's much more fun.
Will the next one be dedicated to Max? Or will Max never, he'll never have a book dedicated to
him? No, he's great. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Am I assuming, and maybe this is private business you don't want to talk about, just say so, we'll go to the next point. But I'm assuming that you're doing well enough now where you can stay home and write all day long. Is that the case?
Yeah, so far. So,
yeah. God bless you. That's great. So you're Mr. Mom, but you're writing. Is that right?
You can. Yeah.
Yeah. You're doing it all at home and writing.
But, you know, a lot of people ask me, though, you know, what are, if I want to be a writer, what, you know, what are the things that I should do? And I do tell them that the first thing is to marry a lawyer.
Yeah. Yeah, that works.
Support you.
Hopefully,
while you're
intellectual property rights lawyer. So, okay, let me ask you this. When you stopped, if you were writing today, whatever you wrote today, what's the percentage of your satisfaction tomorrow when you read it over?
Oh, it's zero.
It's zero. You don't like it, do you? No.
But you revise it, you make it better, you find the parts that are good, and you know, every time you go back to it, I do a lot of revising.
You do.
And you know, every time you make it a little.
When you revise, do you throw that out? I mean, do you throw out the original?
Today, I wrote.
November 10th today you wrote something. But tomorrow morning, November 11th, you're going to get up and read that and say you're dissatisfied with it. You crumple it up and throw it away?
No.
You save it.
Yeah. You never know.
And you never know, right?
Sometimes it's not as bad as you
thought it would.
Thank you either.
Do you bounce this off anybody before you revise? Do you let your wife read it?
Well, you know, my wife doesn't read my novels. Only if you knew her at all, you would know that there's no way that I could give her a chapter to read and say, okay, you know, that somebody's killed, and then say, okay, you'll find out who did it in 2 years. Yeah, no way. She'd never put up with that. So, I mean, she knows what my books are about, but she doesn't read them until they're done.
Now, the book you're writing now, you're under contract to write that book.
Right.
Is that duress for you? Do you feel pressure there? Is that distasteful?
I mean, I feel there's two different kinds of pressure, I think, that, you know, which are interesting. One is to duplicate what I did in the first one in some way, and the other is to not repeat myself. You know, and those are sort of opposing forces. Knopfler's very generous with my deadline, so I will probably at some point be feeling deadline.
This is in no way a sequel to the previous novel.
No, another literary thriller, psychological thriller. But
no remnants of any characters from the first novel in this one. No one even similar.
No.
Whole new world.
Yeah. I mean, some of the themes carry over.
And Knopf has been good to you? Been good to you?
They've been great.
Treated you fairly. Huh?
Yeah,
well, that's
sure
another. That's another good story, because you hear so many authors are dissatisfied with their publishers and their editors.
No. Your editor's a terrific editor, yeah.
Congenial? Yeah. Male or female?
Female. Jordan Pavlin is her name.
In New York City?
Yep.
And how do you transmit what you've written to her? Electronically? Does she help with revision?
She will in this book. I mean, she did on the first one too. Although the first, with that book, the book was finished before she got a complete manuscript, and then she read it and called my agent and said, "I'd like to make an offer on it."
Yeah.
Now this time it's going to be a little bit different. I'll send her part of manuscript. Probably in another month or so. I'll send her 150 pages or something like that, and you know I'll start getting feedback on that portion of it.
I see.
And then so over the next year, you know, this will sort of write.
It's quite a discipline, isn't it? It's quite a discipline, much like taking 1,000 swings in the batting cage, except probably even more arduous. Kevin, it's been really good and enlightening having you. Thank you so much. I hope kids and parents were listening. There is room for literacy in sports. Here's a graduate of professional sports who is extremely literate and still in all of that. All of that still survives. I need to thank Now Serving for having us on Hillgrove. Thank you so much, Mr. Paul Link, owner. I want to thank Mike Mueller, and John Kim, and Kim Gorey on camera, my director, Tom Sklarsky, my producer, who is back this November. He's come back to work with us again, Mr. Mike May. Again, I'm Terry Sullivan, and this has been The Inside Corner. Thanks for so much. Join us again, won't you?
Three, two,
okay.